The first vaccination ever happened on May 14th of 1796, when Edward Jenner inoculated James Phipps. This is an engraving by E.C. Hammond that is held in the New York Academy of Medicine Library. And what we see here is the depiction of that first vaccination ever in the world. What I'm putting in here is a written account of this vaccination from Jenner. The original handwritten draft is held at the Royal College of Surgeons in London. So that's why we know exactly the precise date and the name of the boy. This engraving was done to publicize the benefits of vaccination. You can see the young woman trusting Dr. Jenner, who has a kind face, and he's going to vaccinate the boy. For some reason, James Phipps became from an eight-year-old to a toddler, but this was for purposes of publicizing the importance of vaccination. You see the maid behind getting herself ready also to be vaccinated, and there is a reference to the cow. That is a very important element in the history of vaccination. I'm not so sure what the importance is of having an angry cat below the table, but let's review what was the important contribution of Jenner in terms of having created the first ever vaccine in the world and using it successfully against smallpox. Abigail Adams was the wife of the second president of the United States, John Adams. And the Adams family papers are held in the Massachusetts Historical Society. The electronic archive is available, and I put in here an image of a copy of the letter that I'm going to be quoting. She writes from Boston on July 13th, 1776. And she begins apologizing to John that it's been almost a month since she wrote last time. But then she says that now that she's arrived in Boston, with all four of our little ones inoculated for the smallpox. So some of you probably have realized the date of the first vaccination against smallpox. It's 1796, and 20 years earlier, Abigail Adams is actually making an account to her husband that she has inoculated her children for the smallpox. So what I want to cover in this talk is, what is the difference between a vaccination and then inoculation? And what is the tremendous contribution that Jenner brought to humanity by creating the first vaccine? And that actually opened the whole field of vaccine development and vaccination. This is an engraving showing Lady Mary Wortley Montagu, who introduced the smallpox inoculation to Western medicine. She's shown in this engraving in Constantinople, and she's dressed with a local attire. Her husband had a diplomatic appointment there. And while she was in the Ottoman Empire, she visited the women there, and she witnessed the practice of inoculation against the smallpox by variolation. She called it engrafting. Importantly, in what is now called a letter to a friend, on April 1st of 1717, she writes a letter that has key elements to understand this technology or this methodology. First, she's saying pus is taken from a mild smallpox blister, and it is introduced into the scratch skin of a previously uninfected person. So she's giving three key components here: active pus from a mild blister, and then the person who's going to be inoculated, you scratch the skin. You have to break out that skin barrier, and then you apply the pus. This individual has to be previously uninfected to smallpox. Then she goes on to explain that the person who's been inoculated would develop a milder case. This is important because if the person had already survived smallpox, they don't develop symptoms. They already are immune. so they will not react to this inoculation. She was really so eager to spare her children that she had her five-year-old son inoculated just a year after she saw this methodology being done, and she described it to her friend. So the important thing is that she sees this done, she understands how it is done, and she can explain in a very short letter, she explains the key components of this kind of inoculation that is done in the Ottoman Empire and that she saw successfully done. The Ottoman Empire has its origins at the end of the 13th century, establishing the House of Osman. By the middle of the 16th century, we have, as the Sultan is Suleiman the Magnificent, and I chose a depiction of Titian that was painted around 1530. His wife was La Sultana Rosa, also painted by Titian, and she was known as Hurrem Sultan, but for the Europeans, she was called Roxalana. And if you thought I made a mistake calling her the wife of the Sultan, it's not a mistake. Sultans never married. However, Suleiman decided to marry Hurrem, and he actually had several sons with her. Normally, the sultans would have the harem, and they had their first concubines, and as soon as one of his partners gave him a son, they would move to the other woman. So there was always one son that had different, the sons had different mothers. But that was an exception with Hurrem Sultan. Their first son, Mehmed, died of smallpox at age 21. And we don't really know if this system of variolation and inoculation of smallpox already had been introduced in the Ottoman Empire, but it definitely was impacting not only the whole empire, but in this case, their firstborn son died of smallpox. Selim was their second son, and he inherited the sultanate from his father. And we don't really know exactly if this method of variolation had already been introduced by Selim, but the story is, or the documentation, is that around 1550s, in the middle of the 16th century, so it could have been with Selim II, that this method was introduced. So this is a map of the Ottoman Empire a century later. But what you see here is, of course, it comprises the whole of Turkey, comprises the whole of Greece, and we also have the Arab countries, the Arab Peninsula and North Africa. And the oral tradition is that the Ottoman Empire got this method of inoculation from the Arabs. We don't really know exactly when. There's different accounts that date as far back as the 7th century, and it seems to have been coming from India through the Arab world to the Ottoman Empire and then to the European Western world, this method of inoculation by variolation. There are some accounts that apparently in China, this practice may date as far back as the 4th century. This is a very nice depicting a methodology of explaining that, again, you need to have an individual with smallpox. You actually take pus from the infected blister, and then that pus is used to inoculate children or adults, but they usually used it for children because adults usually already had exposure to smallpox. So to prevent death due to smallpox, they would inoculate them. This inoculation was done in China by the method of nasal for inhalation. So the pus was actually introduced in the nose and the child or the individual that was being inoculated would inhale this pus. The method that was developed in India and the one that the Arabs used, again, I'm going to use the same engraving from China. It's taking the pus from the blister, but instead of inoculating by inhalation, the inoculation was done by scratching the skin of a healthy individual and applying the pus on top. And the reaction would be noted, usually on that arm, with a strong reaction, but it was a mild disease in terms that it did not become systemic. In this watercolor painting from the Welcome Image Library, it is shown the difference that was explained for the European Western world between the smallpox inoculation by variolation on the left and the cowpox inoculation that is called vaccination. So it is a very clear depiction of a comparison. When you use material from a human being that's infected, the reaction can be very severe. When you use it from the cow, using material from cowpox cross-reacts in terms of immunity that conveys immunity to the smallpox. But because you inoculated with cowpox, the individual does not develop smallpox. What they develop is the immune response to smallpox. This was the key observation that Jenner took from history and from historical accounts, and he realized the importance of using cowpox. This is a detail from Wavenhoe Park by Jay Constable. Of course, the cows have been friends to the humans for a very, very long time. And in this case, yet another convenient advantage that the cows are bringing to humankind was found by Jenner in 1796. The Myth of the Milkmaid by Arthur Boylston is a paper published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2018. And this is The Milkmaid, an oil on canvas by Julien Dupré. That dates more or less of the same time that Edward Jenner had been doing his experiments with the cowpox. So I thought it was contemporary, and it's a very nice depiction of a milkmaid and a cow. So Dr. Boylston tells us that almost all the histories of vaccination tell us about Edward Jenner, that he became aware of the benefits of the cowpox infection from talking to a milkmaid, and that this milkmaid told him that she was immune to smallpox because she had had cowpox. In medical school, we are told this, and I'm sure that in other disciplines, people also know about the story of Jenner that learned from the milkmaid about this particular event. What Dr. Boylston tells us is that this is a myth. The story is a myth invented 13 years after Jenner's death with the best of intentions. It was for the reputation of Jenner. And actually, this became a very romantic idea on the milkmaid and how the milkmaids had perfect skins and they eventually transformed into beautiful women because they actually had been exposed on hands. They did have some lesions on cowpox from milking the cows, but then they did not have smallpox. Well, what a surprise. We have been lied to. But Dr. Boylston actually explains the sequence of events. In 1768, John Fuster, Hugh Grove, and Daniel Sutton were three doctors in the UK who began inoculating people against the smallpox. So this inoculation required having people who were sick with the smallpox, they take pus from the lesion and they inoculate people who have never had smallpox. For this method to work, this inoculation has to be on people who have never had smallpox, and what you expect is for them to have a mild reaction. This is today, we call it reactivity to the drug. This is actually telling us the immune system is identifying what you are inoculating. So what John Pewster actually presented this and talked about this in 1768, and he said, well, what we discovered from the case of a farmer who was several times inoculated, and every time it was not effective. He had absolutely no symptoms, and they were baffled because they kept asking him, are you sure you have never had smallpox? And he was saying, no, I've never suffered smallpox. Until in John Fuster's account, he said, I have had the cowpox lately to a violent degree, if that's any odds. So it's not only this case, but during their continuous going on inoculating, they realized that this had actually been the case for several of the farmers, that when they did not have a reaction to the smallpox, is because they had had a history of cowpox as well. So apparently in the audience, when John Pewster is talking about this, it's a mentor of Edward Jenner, who in 1768 was not in medical school yet. And so Edward Jenner learns from his mentor the story, and he actually starts thinking that there might be some value to it. And he then decides to inoculate the first boy, with the cowpox and use this technology to make sure that he can actually create defenses against the smallpox by cross-inoculating with cowpox material. And this is the value of Edward Jenner, the observation that instead of using human individuals that are sick with the virus, which is the inoculation that Fuster, Grove, and Sutton were doing, he was using the cowpox material to inoculate people. And by doing this, his idea is there's less likelihood of having a severe disease. It is interesting that when Jenner publishes his results in 1796, apparently Fuster wrote saying that he was surprised because he always thought this had no real value, his observation, because he perceived the cowpox to be a worse disease than the human disease. So in any case, the value of Edward Jenner is making the observation, applying it, and publicizing it in 1796. So what is the origin of the word vaccination? In Latin, vacca is cow, same as in Spanish. And I really love this painting by Marianne Stokes, Child with Cough. To me, this actually tells us a lot about the story of vaccination. So the Latin word vaccinae is an adjective that means relative to cows. In Spanish, we say anything that comes from a vaca, it's vacuno or vacuna. And vacuna is the same word we use in Spanish for vaccine. So this explanation to me is always easier to do it in Spanish. But it works in English too. It's just referring to the word vaca in Latin and vaccinae, which comes from vaca. So the cowpox material is a vaccine because it's a vaccine material. It's from the cow. So the material is called vaccine, and the injection itself then was known as vaccination. Before Jenner publicized the use of vaccination, and he first did it specifically using the cowpox material. Anything before that, since the 1550s, that had been documented was from human infection to a human individual. And this was called inoculation. And if it was done through scratching the skin, it was called variolation. So vaccination begins in 1796 with Edward Jenner. Now let me talk to you about the story of Francisco Javier de Balmes. He was a military doctor that was born in Alicante, Spain, and he led the Real Expedición Filantrópica de la Vacuna that was sponsored by Charles IV of Spain, very well known for Goya paintings, besides his historical events. But this expedition went from 1803 to 1806, and the aim was to vaccinate millions against the smallpox. Now, he's using the right word. Dr. Balmes had read about Jenner, and he wanted to use this technology of vaccinating and bringing it to the Spanish America and Asia. It is no surprise that this was imperative for the Spanish Empire. The natives from the colonies had been dying from disease, and especially smallpox, in oftentimes in greater numbers than from the war and from the bellicose encounters. The smallpox was really decimating the native populations, and this was something that was important to do. And of course, we are now, you know, centuries after the conquista, but this was still a problem in the Americas and in the Philippines. So Dr. Balmes decided to bring the mission of vaccinating millions against the smallpox. Why? Because he said vaccination, again, this is coming from the cowpox, is much safer than the older methods of inoculation, which would be using human product or human infection. And he knew, and he said, this has been introduced successfully by Edward Jenner in 1798. So again, Dr. Balmes is using the observations from Jenner, and he starts the expedition in Coruña in 1803. They left from the Hospicio de Coruña, and they went to first San Juan de Puerto Rico, they went to Caracas, Havana. You can see in the map, there's not only one expedition, there were several expeditions, but they did bring the vaccination to these colonies. So if you think about this, how did he do it? There were no ways to culture. They didn't even know that it was a virus. So what they knew is that you need to have the cowpox material alive or ready to be able to infect a person with a milder disease. And they knew that, you know, this cowpox material did not last forever being active in producing a successful vaccination. So his solution to the problem was to bring the cowpox material in the paws with 22 orphan children. These 22 orphan children were selected in Spain between the ages of about 6, I believe was the youngest one, and about, I think, 11, the oldest one, something like that. But they were young children. And what he did was to inoculate with the cowpox the first pair of children. And then waiting for the incubation time, he calculated 22 children were needed because he knew how much time the cowpox disease that would be elicited with the vaccination would cause the pus to still be a good material for inoculating the next pair of children. He did it by pairs, just in case one of the children died or did not have a reaction. So he had sort of an idea of how many he needed to have in the ships alive by the time they came to the Americas. And of course, once the child had been vaccinated and successfully went through the symptomatic period, after that, that child was no longer useful. Some of these children returned to Spain after the expedition was over, and some of them apparently did stay in the colonies. There's a very good production from Radio Televisión Española. It's a production from 2016, and it's called 22 Ángeles, 22 Angels. And it's a production that talks about this journey of the 22 orphan children. But this was a successful expedition. They did inoculate millions of people. Who knows how many lives they actually saved? And this was by 1803, the best way for Dr. Balmis to make sure that he could protect the peoples of the Americas and Philippines. And, you know, we could have a long discussion about the way he did it, but this was the best way at the time for inoculating that many people in the Americas and saving that many lives. So this is a summary of the timeline for smallpox. And of course, I refer you to the CDC page on the history of smallpox and also a paper published in 2012. It is believed that about 60 to 16,000 years ago, there's an ancestral strain derived from the African rodent virus. And what I'm depicting here is a picture of a rodent from Kenya. These rodents were actually giants. They were really very big, but these are the ancestral rodents. And it is likely, when I looked at the time of this fossil and this description from the strain, it's likely that it would have been some of a rodent like this one. What we have then in the timeline is that about 63 to 1400 years ago, it's a second clade. This seems to have come from West Africa and seems to have diverged from the ancestral strain slightly. It is the one that continued growing. Now, in the 12th century before Christ, we see that the mummy of Ramesses V of the 20th dynasty of Egyptian pharaohs that was discovered in 1898 bears the signs on the skin of what is thought to be one of the earliest manifestations of smallpox. There's also an account that there's about at least three other mummies from this 20th dynasty that bear the marks of smallpox. We don't know if it's the same virus of the West African strain or if it's a change, but they're all viruses that are DNA viruses, and they all seem to be coming from the same ancestral strain. The story becomes a bit better documented in the 4th century. It's the earliest written description in China, and also it's when we find the descriptions of the inoculation via inhalation. By the 7th century, the descriptions appear in India, which probably came through the Silk Road trading. And then from India, it spreads into Asia, Northern Africa, and Europe through the Arab world, coming all the way to the 10th and 11th century with clear descriptions of the smallpox disease. It is in the middle of the 16th century, by 1550, when we actually have a description of what seems to be now the same disease that was known at the time of its eradication. The smallpox has a fancy classification. You can see there from Wikipedia. It has a lot of different names and middle names and middle names and last names and etc. But we know it as variola virus. And this is the virus that was eradicated almost 2 centuries after Jenner first published his hope that the vaccination using cowpox material from the vaca would annihilate smallpox, which is the human virus. So his technology took 200 years, but it was achieved, and the world was proclaimed by the World Health Assembly officially free of smallpox in 1980. I hope you liked this brief description of the history of vaccination, and please subscribe to my channel and watch other videos that I have created. I enjoyed making this video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it. Thank you.